Macmillan Audio presents Madame Claude by William Stadiem. Read for you by Eliza Foss and Keith Sellon-Wright.
Introduction. If the measure of a person's power is the magnitude and amplitude of the secrets he or she keeps, then Madame Claude was surely one of the most powerful people in the world when I met her in Los Angeles in 1981. From 1957 to 1977, Madame Claude had been the unofficial Madame de la République of the old guard regimes of Charles de Gaulle and his successor Georges Pompidou, catering to the sexual whims of fellow heads of state, royalty, tycoons, and stars who bestrode the earth. It was her connection to Hollywood and her panoply of celebrity clients that had occasioned her relocation to the West Coast. Notwithstanding the blandishments of Beverly Hills, despite the sun and despite the stars, her loyal stars, when I first encountered the elegant French queen of sex, she seemed as dispirited in her exile as Napoleon on Sainte Helena. Madame Claude had fled France in 1977 in the face of looming criminal charges that she had evaded taxes on millions of dollars in undeclared income. What she denounced as a political witch hunt was couched by the new centrist government of Valéry Giscard d'Estaing as an effort to show the world that France's commitment to American-style modernity was more than allowing a few McDonald's to open on the Champs-Élysées. Giscard was waging an anti-prostitution campaign against the supermadam, who was considered the embodiment of France's decadent Ancien Régime. Claude herself detested the P-word. She vehemently maintained that her famous clientele wasn't paying for sex. They were paying for an experience, a spectacle. Claude wasn't in the sordid business of putting bodies in beds. She was in the rarefied business of making the dreams of the world's biggest dreamers come true. If Paris was the capital of sex, Madame Claude was the capitalist of sex. In her late 50s, as chic and slim and blonde as the most high-toned Paris socialite, Madame Claude held court at the high tables of Hollywood's power restaurants as filmdom's leading actors, agents, and moguls compulsively table-hopped to kiss the hand that had answered the magic telephone that could turn any celluloid fantasy into reality. For her alchemy, and for basically creating and perfecting the concept of the call girl, Madame Claude had become rich, one of the richest entrepreneurial women in the world of her time. She was to Eros what Coco Chanel was to fashion, elegant, imperious, and entirely self-made. If she weren't trading in sex, she could have been a beacon of feminism, a genuine role model. Ever since I had first discovered Paris as a student, I had been aware of Madame Claude. She was as French as the Eiffel Tower. A date with a Claude girl, as they were known, was one of those pinnacle Paris experiences, like staying at the Ritz or dining at Maxime's or wearing a Lanvin suit that I never expected to have, an apotheosis of luxury that the French do better than any other nationality. Yet here I was in Beverly Hills, hanging out with the woman who knew more about the private lives of the world's brand names, names like Kennedy, Rothschild, Mountbatten, Agnelli, Onassis, Pahlavi, Saud, Sinatra, Brando, than anybody else. My mission was to convince her to collaborate with me on a book about those names and about those lives, as well as the lives of the women she called her swans, the Cinderellas to whom she played the role of the most outrageous fairy godmother who ever existed. I had a simple title for the book, Sex and Power. Nobody could tell it better than she. I thought it was a project that, aside from its potential pecuniary rewards, might help relieve the entropy of Claude's American displacement. Because Claude's initial affect was that of a banker, a woman of high finance, I fell prey to the image of her as a James Bond villainess, a Lady Ulrich Goldfinger. But as I got to know her, I saw that Madame Claude did not love only gold. Even more, she loved to talk, to tell stories, to provide the lowdown on the high-ups. She was as acute as William Buckley, as incisive as Joan Rivers and Don Rickles combined. In short, Madame Claude was great fun, though you didn't want to be on her bad side, as was the current French government and the establishment that had reneged on a collective promise to always protect her, as she had always protected them. Now that this unique social contract had been breached, it seemed that the act of telling the truth, the awful truth, might set Madame Claude free. She certainly enjoyed telling it to me. I often asked her if she were afraid of reprisal. This, she waved around at the movie stars and the foie gras and the vintage wines of the restaurant where we were dining, this was the reprisal, her own gilded cage. As for the reprisal of a more corporeal sort, Madame Claude was one of the most fearless people I had ever met. She fused the politesse of an Avenue Fauche doyenne with the sangfroid of a mafia capo. Claude knew exactly how weak male flesh could be. She had catered to the flesh of rulers, of despots, of dictators, of arms merchants, of wielders of immense deadly power. She knew what they needed and wanted, and was utterly confident that her unique ability to provide femininity on its ultimate level would be her perennial protective shield. As for the swans, who were her trademark, to believe the politically correct party line that Madame Claude had relocated to the epicenter of American beauty to retire from the sex trade and open a pastry shop would have been beyond naive. With stunning actresses and models to groom and perfect and rich and famous men to introduce them to, how could Madame Claude possibly resist the siren call of Alexander Graham Bell to seize the line and make the match? It would have been like inviting Michael Jordan onto a basketball court and not expecting him to take a shot. Madame Claude was truly the Nijinsky of the fix-up. I spent several months talking and talking with Madame Claude in Los Angeles, during which we somehow became friends. I was a good listener. Then again, with the adventures she could recount, who wouldn't have been? In the course of our unlikely relationship, I ended up meeting many of the legends of the world whose mandate was to create legends. There was a factor here of guilt by association. If I could be keeping company with Madame Claude, I perforce must be someone worth knowing. That was entertainment. I also met a number of her swans, some local, others imported from Europe, all special, and all relentlessly ambitious, even for Hollywood. I got a vivid idea as to how Madame Claude played the headmistress of her very unique finishing school. Above all, I was amassing a treasure trove of material for the book she was warming to with each new story she told. And then, without warning, Madame Claude made what is known as a French exit, leaving without a trace, without a goodbye. I later learned that with the French taxmen and the American immigration men breathing down on her, she had made another great escape, this time to her cattle ranch in the South Pacific. By 1985, with the socialist François Mitterrand in office, Claude must have thought the coast was clear. She returned to France, to her country sheep farm. For the first time in her formerly charmed life, Madame Claude made the wrong gambit. She was arrested and sent to prison, not once, but twice, in a tragic downhill decade in which the Queen of Sex tried to resume a throne that her ever-Americanizing country had abolished. Between Madame Claude's incarcerations, thwarted reincarnations, and eventual relocation to the Riviera, I never was able to connect with her again. She died in Nice in 2015. She was 92. She had seen it all, done it all. Few women have walked a higher wire. Although the book we had talked about doing together never got done, I decided I would have to do it myself. The true story of Madame Claude, her saga of sex and power, was a novelistic epic of self-creation, of ambition, risk, triumph, and tragedy that had to be told. Here it is.
Chapter 1. Introductory French. Camelot was coming to Paris. It was their first official European tour, and the first couple couldn't have been more excited. While Jackie Kennedy was thrilled to be meeting one of her literary idols, the new French Minister of Culture, André Malraux, man's fate, who was going to give her a special tour of the Louvre, the person John Kennedy may have been thinking the most about was Madame Claude, who was going to provide JFK with her own take on man's fate. It was a rendezvous with destiny that the new president had been plotting for weeks. After the Bay of Pigs fiasco in April 1961, John Kennedy had decided that he needed to re-jumpstart his presidency. The best way to get global attention as a new world statesman and rebut his Cuban misadventure was to meet with two of the key statesmen of the old world, Charles de Gaulle and Nikita Khrushchev, on their home turf of Europe. But just because JFK was doing serious business overseas didn't mean that he would keep in abeyance his obsessive sex drive, which was turning the White House into a cat house of well-bred aides who spent more time in the swimming pool and afterward the Lincoln bedroom than in the typing pool. If JFK's on-the-job bedhopping at the White House was resulting in something of a French bedroom farce, what better place to continue the production than Paris itself? And what better side benefit to such a diplomatic excursion than to sample the treasures and pleasures of Madame Claude, whom JFK had recently heard about through his jet-set playboy network of Frank Sinatra, Igor Cassini, and Porfirio Rubirosa, all of whom had regaled him with tales of this new, young, 30-ish, and elegant procuress, who specialized in turning the high-propriety daughters of the post-war nouvelle pauvre French aristocracy into filles de joie. If JFK had a type, it was the wholesome, snooty, proper, preppy girl whose flaunted untouchability, call it a cordon sanitaire, he could violate, like the girls at Miss Porter's or Ethel Walker, who inflamed his adolescent lust when he was at Choate and Harvard. Girls just like Jacqueline Bouvier, whom he had to marry to have his way with, and then quickly realized that one way wasn't enough. Here was a madam who specialized in exactly what JFK was after. Of course, the president had as many exceptions to his rule and his type as there were beautiful women who crossed his path. Marilyn Monroe, his latest obsession, was hardly the Farmington type. Nor was Judy Campbell, who had shared beds with not only JFK, Sinatra, and the Chicago mob boss, Sam Giancana, but also with his father, Joseph, whom everyone still called Mr. Ambassador, from his stint as Franklin D. Roosevelt's man at the court of St. James. JFK called his father Big JP. Still, Judy Campbell, for all her California non-preppiness, was a convent school girl who exuded the same sort of pedigreed purity that Jackie offered, and that was the trademark and stock-in-trade of this new Madame Claude. JFK couldn't wait. JFK had no aversions to prostitution, whatever its level of euphemism, nor to sharing a mistress with his father. He was a chip off the old block. Despite their Irish Catholic heritage and their roots in Puritan Boston, the Kennedys, at least the male Kennedys, were anything but blue stockings where sex was concerned, particularly commercial sex. After all, Joe, one of the biggest of American big businessmen, thought it was only natural to combine his two great passions, sex and commerce. While at Choate, John Kennedy had lost his virginity to a white streetwalker in Harlem,
an experience he recounted to his choate classmate and best friend, Lemoyne Billings. When he was at Harvard and Joe was ambassador to England, father took son on a grand tour of some of the legendary legal bordellos, or maison close, of Paris, which were basically deluxe hotels where no one ever slept alone. Le 122, for example, named for its number on the Rue de Provence behind the Galerie Lafayette department store, was included.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.